Good morning, it's breakfast time, 6:30 on Tuesday the 30th of August. A very good morning to you. The theme this morning is very definitely shuttle. In about 40 minutes, we'll be going live to Cape Canaveral to watch the launch of the latest United States space shuttle. It's the first night launch. It's actually 1:30 in the morning now, and we're promised spectacular pictures. Morning, Frank.
Good morning. We'll also be watching how British Airways get on as they launch their super shuttle service to Glasgow by Concorde. Would you believe there have been people queuing at Heathrow all night? Place in chaos, we hear. And our guests this morning are among the most loved of all British comedians, Mr. Terry Scott and Mr. Eric Sykes, with a cup of tea. He's wakening up. We're leaving him until a little later on. They open on the West End stage together later tonight. But first, let's catch up with the overnight news headlines. Here's Andrew Harvey. Good morning, Andrew.
Good morning. President Reagan says American troops will stay with the peacekeeping force in Lebanon despite the deaths of two Marines yesterday. Mr. Reagan expressed his sorrow at the deaths of the two men, but said the size and duties of the American forces would remain unchanged. The two Marines became the first American casualties in the fighting when Shiite militiamen launched mortar attacks against the Lebanese army near Beirut Airport. American helicopters retaliated to prevent further casualties, and it's feared that could make them a prime target for future attacks. Mr. Begin is expected to announce at noon today whether or not he's resigning as Prime Minister of Israel. The announcement will follow a meeting with members of his ruling coalition. The hijacked French airliner is still sitting on the runway at Tehran Airport. The hijackers had set a new deadline for action from the French government on their demands, but that's now passed without incident. Michael Meacher, the left-wing candidate for Labour's deputy leadership, says a future Labour government shouldn't carry out unilateral nuclear disarmament unless it has the majority support of the British people. He said that might mean holding a referendum. The American space shuttle Challenger is due to blast off from Cape Canaveral in 3/4 hour. Storms have caused fears of postponement, but NASA officials are confident that the launch will go ahead as planned. Tickets for the cheapest ever Concorde flight went on sale at Heathrow this morning to people who'd queued all night. Concorde takes off at 7:15 for Glasgow to launch British Airways' new super shuttle service to Scotland, aimed at beating the rival British Midland service. In future, most passengers will fly in Boeing 757s, although Concorde will be used from time to time. The streets of Notting Hill were jammed with dancers again last night as the West Indian Carnival came to an end. Both the organisers and the police say it was the biggest and best so far, with more than 250,000 people attending over the 2 days. And I'll be back at 7 o'clock with the main summary. Frank.
Thank you very much.
Challenger is due to take off from Cape Canaveral in Florida in a few minutes' time. Storms in the area had caused fears of a postponement, but NASA officials say they're confident Challenger will be launched on schedule at 7:15. It's the first nighttime launch in the shuttle program, and it should be visible to spectators up to 450 miles away. The five crew members, including the first black astronaut, were woken up at 3 o'clock this morning for a meal and a brief physical checkup. 500,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen and oxygen were pumped into the shuttle's fuel tanks in preparation for the 6-day flight. On board are a communications and weather satellite to be put into orbit for India, an experiment for making pure drugs, 250,000 stamped envelopes for collectors, and 6 rats to be studied by scientists. Well, we're now receiving live pictures of Challenger from the Kennedy Space Center at Cape Canaveral. And we'll be showing the launch as it happens at 7:15. The countdown is going ahead as scheduled. The Notting Hill Carnival came to a close early this morning.
I've been to the Kennedy Space Center in Florida for the takeoff. In fact, we can see the missile, as it were, on the pod now. Ian Ridpath is with me. What news of the countdown? It's a little bit delayed, I hear.
Yes, they seem to be having trouble with the weather, but other than that, that's the only thing that's delaying them. All other aspects of the countdown have gone according to plan. The astronauts have been aboard for quite some time, and they seem quite happy about things, so they're just waiting for a go on the weather at the moment.
Why are they taking off in the dark this time?
Oh, well, it's to do with getting the satellite on, that they have on board into the right orbit. It's a satellite for the Indian government, and it will eventually end up in a high orbit over the Indian Ocean. And as an interesting sidelight to having a night launch, which should give us spectacular pictures when they eventually go. They will also be having a night landing in 6 days' time. They will be flying the thing back to the Edwards Air Force Base in California, and the runway is going to be lined with arc lamps. So in addition to having spectacular launch pictures today, we may very well get spectacular landing pictures on Monday morning.
Does a night takeoff and land add any additional hazards to the thing?
Certainly a night landing is going to be more awkward than a normal daytime landing, but I don't really, if everything goes according to plan, there should really be no problem. Normally, the weather can be better at night. One of the problems with launching during the daytime from Florida is that you can get sudden, particularly in the summer, you can get sudden thunderstorms springing up from nowhere, and we've seen launches threatened and indeed landings put off because of bad weather. So it may be that in future, if everything goes successfully on this flight, we may see more nighttime operations of the shuttle. In a way, it's rather ironic that the weather seems to be a problem right now.
Well, as we see these live pictures coming in, tell me a little bit about this Indian satellite. What is that going to do? And they launched that into orbit.
Yes, that's a rather interesting satellite. It's a satellite which will be used both for relaying weather data in India and also for communications. And it's going to be sufficiently big and powerful that it can beam television transmissions direct to small portable ground stations, which can be set up in villages around India. All you need is a small portable receiving dish a few feet across and a television set, which can be set up in the village hall. So therefore, remote villages, which don't even have schools, can get lessons beamed direct to them via this satellite. And this is one use of communication satellites for bringing education to developing countries that people such as myself have been waiting to see developed for quite some time. So I think this is a very important advance.
Yes, one would have thought that in India they needed to concentrate on things rather more than satellites, food and help and disease and all those kind of things.
Well, the root of it all is education, and places which don't have education, you've got to teach people about agriculture, how to improve agriculture, matters of hygiene, birth control and so on. So these kind of things are actually extremely important to developing nations, and it is, I think, a rather nice example of the way in which high technology can in fact help developing nations in the way they need most. But that's not all that the shuttle has got on board. They've got a little processing experiment up in front where the five astronauts are seated and will be living. This is used for processing medical drugs and pharmaceuticals, and on this particular flight they'll be processing samples which will be used for research into diabetes.
What do you mean processing them? Doing what to them up there? Does it matter?
Purifying things. Now, in the weightless conditions of space, you can actually purify and separate out medical samples much more. You get much greater purity and much more of them than you do on the ground, where gravity interferes with the process that you're trying to do. So it turns out that weightlessness up there in orbit is actually a good place to do certain of these kind of experiments. So it does actually make it worthwhile going into space.
These crewmen must be amazing people, really. I mean, you need to be a biochemist as well as be able to fly a shuttle to go up there, don't you?
Yes. Well, nowadays, the image of the astronaut as a kind of a big He-Man pilot has very much changed. The emphasis these days is on scientific qualifications, and the whole spectrum of people who are going into space has been opening up. Of course, on the last flight, we saw the first American woman, Sally Ride. And it's notable that this particular mission contains America's first black astronaut, Guyon Bluford. And there's also a doctor on board, William Thornton, who's studying how people's bodies react to the change when you go into space. And that's something that they're still trying to sort out, why some people do get sick on their first few days in space. So I think it's quite possible that in years to come, if not us, but certainly our children will be able to go to Cape Canaveral and to sit on something like the space shuttle and be shot into orbit, possibly for a holiday. You know, we've seen Walt Disney's Epcot Center in Florida. Well, I think Walt Disney will probably be setting up some kind of fun place in the sky.
Well, I tell you, I'm told that it's T-minus 9 and they're holding at the moment. I don't know, perhaps Francis will have a word about the weather a little later on to see what's causing the problem. I mean, what could it be? Cloud or...?
Yes, really just cloud. They've got to have clear skies, because in the event that anything went wrong early in the launch, they would have to do a very tricky piece of flying of turning the shuttle round and bringing it back to the landing strip at the Kennedy Space Center at Cape Canaveral in Florida. And to do that, they must have clear weather, and they won't go unless they've got clear weather. In all, the launch window is open for about half an hour, so we should see them going sometime in the next 30 minutes.
But when you say the launch window, they have got to go within the half an hour allocated. Yes, fine. Well, I tell you what, live television also has hazards, as well as launching shuttles. As I say, it's T-minus 9, they're holding, and of course we'll be slotting in this launch whenever it happens. We'll get warning of it happening, and and you certainly won't miss it. In the meantime, it's just turned 7:15, in fact, just on 7:15. Coming up in the next 15 minutes on Breakfast Time, the pick of the morning papers.
Something like this, they can't afford to waste too much time because I understand there's about a 45-minute window.
Yes, can you explain briefly what a window is?
Well, it's a window in time, actually, and I would suspect that the window on this particular launch is probably constrained by the launch of the Indian communication satellite.
Yeah.
The reason they have a night launch is to get that in particularly the right place in orbit for for launch. And I would imagine if they slip very much that that's going to be the constraining thing. So you got about a 45-minute window this morning where, as it gets closer to the end of that 45 minutes, the crew is going to be probably nervous. I mentioned before that they aren't apprehensive, but anything that delays the flight and they think can scrub it always means, well, you know, it has to be another day, or they might not even get a chance. After living with it for 5, 8, or in Bill Thornton's case, 18 years,
oh.
You don't believe you've really got a mission until the bolts blow and it lifts off.
Yeah.
The suspense must be terrible.
Yeah, and what's that haze we can see? Is that just ordinary heat haze of the night?
Well, it looks to me like it's kind of thermals between where you're watching. The cameras are probably
quite a long way away.
Quite a long ways away. A very long lens, and so you're getting the atmospherics between where it's sitting.
What's the white sort of steam coming from the bottom? That's perfectly normal, presumably.
Well, that's I think that's what you also may be seeing there is there's undoubtedly a water basin. You see, when they in order to absorb the heat of all, from all that. Thrust from the engines, from the rocket engines when they fire up, they're going to be converting steam. The water gets converted to steam, and you may be seeing the heat gradients off of that water. Cool.
Now, you mentioned the Indian satellite. What else are they trying to achieve this time?
Well, there's a long list of what they call mission objectives or detailed test objectives, but for our purposes, probably the main ones we would think about are the launch of the Indian satellite. It's a communication satellite and was a late substitute, I understand, for the tracking and data relay satellite. As you may recall, STS-6 it was, they launched one and had a problem getting it in the right place in orbit. Had to do a lot of working with it, and they were supposed to launch a second one on this particular mission. Since they didn't know exactly what had caused the problem before, they decided to delay that. This communication satellite was substituted. Probably the most important operational objective for this particular mission is the night launch and the night recovery, which just expands the envelope of planned missions later on.
Yeah. You'll be interested to hear that we've got an idea that it might be at the earliest within 9 minutes from now, is that right?
10 or 12 minutes, apparently, yes.
It's changing all the time.
Presumably, an astronaut's training actually involves being able to withstand suspense like this.
This is really quite routine. And
glad to hear.
It sounds silly, maybe, to tell it to the layman, but the mission is almost anticlimactic from the training. I mean, the training is, in many ways, the demands that it places on a crewman is much more demanding than the 4 or 5 days in space.
Well, while we wait,
we'll get on with our routine, which is a little less hair-raising.
Which is called competition time.
The Space Centre at Cape Canaveral. Are you terribly enthused by this, gentleman? I mean, it's the eighth. The eighth time this shuttle has gone up. I mean, does it still grab you like it did the first time?
Oh, yeah, if it gets to Glasgow on time, I think that's all you require. I mean, this marvellous shuttle, isn't it?
Well, I couldn't care less because when they landed on the moon, I thought, right, we can get to the moon, but we've got problems down here we can't even solve. I mean, so why suddenly go up to the moon?
It's very strange, isn't it, that when they landed on the moon, everybody said, that is absolutely wonderful, terrific, and the whole nation was thrilled. We all sat up all night on a monumental occasion. I was with some people the following day, and they had another report on the second day or the first day of the moon, and I was sitting with these people, and of course they were black and white pictures from the moon. And somebody went and kicked the set and said, this is a terrible picture, isn't it? You know, in other words, you know, it was a miracle one day, and the next day it's just absolutely ordinary. Ian, would you agree with that? Do people, do you think, sort of lose interest or what? I mean, I'm still very excited by this thing going off.
Yes, I am. I think there is now a whole new generation of people who have been turned onto space, particularly the younger generation, people who probably weren't even born when the first men landed on the moon, because, you know, we're all getting on a bit. You know, let's remember that the first landing on the moon was in 1969, which is, what, 14 years ago now. And I was astounded when I went to Stansted Airport to when the Space Shuttle Enterprise came in on its visit on the back of the jumbo jet. Everybody had turned out to see that space shuttle. There were queues on the M11. People were pushing babies in pushchairs across fields to get there. The world and his wife and their kids and the dogs had turned out to see the space shuttle. I was really astounded. I thought there would be a lot of interest, but I didn't think there would be that much interest. Plus, of course, all the people who lined the bridges in the middle of London as well. There must have been millions of people who turned out to see that space shuttle. And I think it had...
Brandon Stein now flipping the three remaining switches in the cockpit to start the three auxiliary power units. APU activation is complete. Hydraulic pressure reported to be normal. This now limits our unplanned hold capability to 7 minutes if we should run into a problem between now.
Yeah, can they abort the mission at any time? Or when they get into a certain few minutes before takeoff, is that...
Can somebody in the loop abort the mission? Yes, right up until an engine shutdown. I don't know what's the latest time you can make an engine shutdown, because the solid rocket boosters are a little bit more difficult to shut down after they once ignite.
So these are slightly different from the one you've flown?
Yes, it's the first time that they've had solid rocket boosters.
But at 5 minutes, T-minus 5 minutes?
Yeah, they can be holds. I mean, you can go right up to... In fact, we had Wally Schirra that was on Apollo 7 with us during one of the Gemini launches, Gemini 6. He went right up to when ignition started, and then they had to shut down and aborted the mission.
Lo, when you were actually watching takeoff, how did you actually feel?
Well, I was curious more than anything and very happy for Walt that he had finally reached his moment of going up into space, because he'd been training for it for so long.
I mean, you must have been through a certain amount of the training as well, along with him.
You learn to be alone a lot, I think, mainly.
What do you feel like when he's actually up there?
It's the only time in our married life that I knew exactly where he was and what he was doing. Hold on. So, you know, I could keep track of him and he didn't have track of me. I enjoyed it.
10 seconds. Engine gimbal checks are complete. Shuttle main engines have been placed in the start position. T-minus 3 minutes and counting. T-minus 2 minutes, 55 seconds. External tank liquid oxygen pressurization has started. Purging of the shuttle main engines is terminated. T-minus 2 minutes, 43 seconds and counting. Retraction has started on the gaseous oxygen vent hood. Ground launch sequencer will make a final check to make sure the vent arm is fully retracted at T-minus 37 seconds. T-minus 2 minutes, 30 seconds and counting. Orbiter test conductor has requested pilot Brandon Stein to clear caution and warning memory system.
These are absolutely meticulous checks, aren't they? The detail and the care is absolutely paramount.
Obviously, they're running down through their preset checklist. The astronauts themselves really don't have to do a great deal. The computers really do all the flying for the first few minutes. But what those astronauts up there will be listening out for is just a few seconds before liftoff. The three main engines at the base of the shuttle light up, and if you're sitting with those five chaps up in the nose end of the shuttle, you hear three quick bangs, boom, 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 as the three main engines light up.
That must be quite reassuring, in a way.
Yes.
At least you know they've started.
You know everything's happening, yes. And then the main engines have to build up to full thrust. And we may just get pictures which show it, but there shows the whole stack. But that whole rocket tilts over very slightly as those main engines build up to full power. That's what's known as the twang. And if you're sitting in your seat up the top there, you're rocked forward by about 20 inches in your seat.
Okay, and let us now listen intently, and we won't interrupt until they've taken off. About a minute to go, I suspect, but let's listen.
T-minus 1 minute and counting. Sound suppression water system now on. Pre-liftoff water will be released at T-minus 16 seconds. T-minus 50 seconds and counting. Hydrogen burn igniters have been armed. T-minus 45 seconds and counting. Solid rocket booster development flight instrumentation recorder is going to the record mode. Main propulsion system, liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen, outboard fill valves have been closed. T-minus 35 seconds and counting. T-minus 31, we have a go for auto sequence start. Challenger's four redundant computer is now assuming primary control of critical vehicle functions from now through liftoff. T-minus 20 seconds and counting. SRB engine nozzle gimbal profile now underway. T-minus 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. We have engine start. 2, 1, 0. We have ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff, 32 minutes after the hour and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
11, 9, clear. Roger, roll.
Houston confirms good roll program. Standing by for main engine throttle down to control structural loads on Challenger during max Q, the period of maximum redundant pressure.
Coming up to the speed of sound now.
50 seconds.
I tell you, it is the rocket to end them all, isn't it, really? The firework to end them all when it goes up like that.
It really
altitude
is,
six
yes,
miles. Downrange 3 miles.
When, at a nighttime launch...
Main engine throttle's going back to 100%.
When, at a nighttime launch... It looks like the sun has risen. The reason that they throttle down and throttle up is what they're talking about is because they're just going through round about the sound barrier, which is not bad going from the standing start to the speed of sound in a minute, and they throttle back slightly to prevent the forces building up.
3,700 feet per second, altitude 12.5 miles, downrange 9 miles.
And the next thing which we have to look out for is in 30 seconds' time, when the two big firework boosters at the side of the shuttle are shot off. There are explosive bolts which fire to shoot these things off, and you'll see a big flash of flame in about 10, 15 seconds from now. It may look as though the whole thing's blown up, but it hasn't.
Standing by for solid rocket booster separation.
Ah,
and we've lost the picture.
Guidance has converged.
And your first stage performance was nominal.
Okay, well, it sounds as though everything is going swimmingly.
You're happy with that, are you?
Yes, it sounds as though they're on their way. We won't know they're safely in orbit for about another 10 minutes yet,
yes.
But we'll keep an eye on it.
Lovely. Well, thank you much, indeed. And they have aboard several canisters, don't they? There are half a dozen rats, which obviously will upset some people, and a snowmaking machine, I gather. What's that for?
That's an experiment which has been sponsored by a Japanese newspaper to try and make ice crystals in space. And the other thing which caught my eye, which I think is rather amusing, that there are a number of sealed canisters in the cargo bay containing upwards of 250,000 postal covers, which the US Post Office are going to sell for $15 a time when they get back to collectors, and which stands to make the Post Office and NASA about $4 million profit.
Well, they've got to pay the petrol bill somehow.
Whoever said there was no
money. Pretty horrendous petrol bill to get that launched. Ian, thank you very much indeed. Well, there we are, Challenger on its way, happily, we're delighted to say, and we're now going to have some more news. Andrew is here. Hello, it's 8 o'clock, Tuesday the 30th of August. You're watching BBC Breakfast Time. Good morning to you. The headlines today, as Israel looks set to pull back her troops in Lebanon, America says her peacekeeping force will stay in Beirut despite the death of two Marines. The CBI's latest forecast is for rising output and inflation. And there are queues at Heathrow as travellers wait for the chance to fly Concorde to Glasgow. With the details today, it's Andrew Harvey.
Good morning. It now seems certain that an Israeli withdrawal in Lebanon is imminent. Forces are believed to be preparing to pull back from the Shuf Mountains to a new defence line along the Awali River. The space shuttle Challenger took off just over half an hour ago from Cape Canaveral in Florida. The launch was held up for a quarter of an hour because of the weather, but it went ahead smoothly and with no further problems. Aboard are five crew members, including the first black astronaut. Our science correspondent James Wilkinson has been watching the launch.
This is the eighth shuttle mission. The shuttle is going to launch an Indian communication and weather satellite and also test once again the remote-controlled arm. Technically, the countdown went perfectly. Cloudy weather held things up at the last minute, but finally the countdown resumed.
We have engine start, 2, 1, 0. We have ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff, 32 minutes after the hour, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
The spectacular night launch lit up the countryside for miles around. They had to launch at night for the first time, so their satellite they're going to launch will be deployed in the right place in 24 hours' time. It's going to be a six-day mission. Much of the time will be taken up with testing a tracking and data relay satellite, launched earlier this year, which will considerably improve NASA's communications with its own satellites. The astronauts have a busy schedule ahead, but at least they're off to a good start.
A British Airways Concorde is now on its way
from... which is roughly an hour ago.
T-minus 2 minutes and counting, coming up on liquid hydrogen pressurization.
All went reasonably well, didn't it, apart from the delay, Walt?
Yeah, the delay I was surprised to find out was due to weather, and apparently really weather at the strip, they call it the skid strip there at Cape Kennedy. In the event of an abort, they would have to fly back and land there. It'd be a night landing, and there was apparently rain over the field. So that was the reason for the delay. But right now, at T-minus 2 minutes, they're going to be... throwing a few last-minute switches, almost everything is done, and it's just kind of filling the squares, the last couple of key items. Mm-hmm. And in a second here, they'll probably go to about, see, T-minus 35 seconds, you're going to go on to an automatic sequencer. At that stage, there's nothing but a very minimal number of switch throwings, everything else. Everybody's getting set into the couch, restrained, and just really getting prepared for liftoff.
SRB engine nozzle gimbal profile now underway.
Very tense moment.
The gimbals inside the vehicle, 11, you can feel 10, these engines. They're 9, testing the engines swinging
8,
back and forth.
7, 6,
ignition
5,
sequence.
We have
and right at
start,
T0,
2,
the solid
1,
rocket boosters on each side light up, and that's what we have there right now. I'm sure that will be the picture that's taken.
It will be in all the newspapers tomorrow.
Because you got all that flame coming out the side. I was a little bit surprised that the flame pattern wasn't bigger, especially as you start reaching the stratosphere. In the Apollo 17 launch, which was also at night, the cones of the flame just spread out tremendously.
Roughly where will they be now then, an hour on?
Well, they're probably coming up, they're past Hawaii, probably someplace between Hawaii and the California coast. They've already gone through two burns on the engines after they went in orbit. The first one to pick up velocity, orbital velocity, the second one then to pick up the perigee so that they're in a 160-mile circular orbit.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll probably operate most of the mission in a 160-mile orbit, changing it probably towards the end to come down for deorbit.
And do you feel that everything's gone according to plan?
Oh, yeah. It's so routine now. It's like you're sitting here, we're covering this very routine. They cut away from it, you know, 1 minute into the launch.
In fact, you were saying it's so routine that people are taking it a bit for granted now. Lo, you said you would be surprised if even your children were up watching it.
I doubt very seriously if they're up watching it.
It's incredible, isn't it, how people have come to take these space shuttles for granted?
I really kind of think it's necessary.
To give you an even better example, it was about the third space shuttle launch, and I still get up in the morning to watch them. They normally come fairly early in the morning in Houston. And I will not forget watching liftoff on the space shuttle. It takes about 10 minutes to get into orbit. I was watching one of the networks, and at about 4 minutes, they cut for a commercial.
Well, Walter, no, thank you very much for being in today and helping talk us through the launch. It really has been very exciting indeed.
Well, it's the first launch I've seen from London.
Yeah.
Exactly. And we could even see it all the way from London.
Yes, thanks very much, Inay. Great to talk to you and
thank you.
The expert's view.
And in just under 10 minutes, we see puffins, seals, eagles and pine martins when animal magic goes cruising. First on BBC One, John Craven's Newsround.
America's astronauts get down to work after the shuttle's first night launch. Hello again. Everything seems to be going according to plan on the eighth mission of the American Space Shuttle, and the five astronauts have just settled down for a few hours' sleep. Bad weather meant that Challenger took off earlier today, 17 minutes late. But the short delay didn't mar the spectacular beauty of the shuttle's first night launch. Newsround space editor Reg Turnell has the details.
A thunderstorm with driving rain as the five-man crew boarded the bus for the launch pad moved away just in time. The commander, Dick Truly, took with him Guyon Bluford, the first black astronaut, and Dr. William Thornton at 54, the oldest man to go into orbit. His job is to find a cure for space sickness.
Critical vehicle functions. T-minus 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5... We have engine start, 2, 1, 0. We have ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff, 32 minutes after the hour and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
The shuttle's first night launch could be seen 700 kilometers away. Six wrecks are sharing the astronauts' sleeping quarters, in a cage, of course. In the payload bay, a quarter of a million stamped envelopes, which NASA and the US Post Office hope will make a profit of £2 million. Thornton started his medical tests as soon as they were in orbit, but no sign of space sickness yet. The astronauts, as always, are thoroughly enjoying the freedom of weightlessness. And first job for Bluford was to start the machine for making very pure medicines for use back on Earth.
And Challenger lifted off this morning for its third flight into space. The launch was delayed for 17 minutes because of bad weather, but it cleared just in time for a perfect countdown.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. We have engine start. 2, 1, 0. We have ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff, 32 minutes after the hour and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
The flames from the blast off were seen more than 400 miles away. The five-man crew are to test an important satellite tracking network. British Airways launched their Super Shuttle service this morning, giving passengers a chance to make the journey from London to Glasgow on Concorde. Demand for tickets was disappointing, but passengers got their first taste of the in-flight food and drink British Airways are now offering on the service. The plane didn't break the sound barrier, but it did travel 22 miles an hour faster than the ordinary shuttle. About 120 firemen are fighting a blaze in a storage...
The sergeant and I set the whole deal up.
Dibble here. Everything back to normal. Okay, Sarge, no hard feelings. All right, what are you hanging around for? Break it up, move along.
And thanks, boys.
TopCat! The most effectual TopCat! Intellectual close friends get to call him TC, providing it's with dignity. Topcat, the indisputable leader of the gang. He's the boss, he's a bit, he's a championship, he's a host tip top. Topcat. Of everything, he's a host tip top.
In just over 5 minutes, the story of the peasant farmer's son who grew up to be king in The Children of Destiny. First on BBC One, John Craven's Newsround.
Under control at last, the huge oil fire that's been blazing in Wales. Hello again. Firemen have finally beaten the massive oil fire that's been raging at an oil refinery in Wales since early yesterday morning. They brought it under control by smothering the blaze with thousands of gallons of special firefighting foam. The fire broke out in one of the large storage tanks at Amoco's oil refinery at Milford Haven in South Wales. Jane Perkins reports.
It now seems that the gallant firefighters in West Wales have won their battle against the burning oil tank at the Amoco refinery. The fire has been raging throughout the night and today, but flames are now subsiding under a blanket of white foam. Firemen from all over Britain dashed to the scene for the dangerous operation that tried to prevent the flames spreading to the surrounding tanks. six firemen were injured when part of the 12 million gallon tank ruptured, spilling blazing oil into the surrounding protective moat. At one stage, the heat was so intense, the covering on a nearby oil tank caught light, but this was quickly extinguished. Thousands of gallons of foam compound were needed to quell the blaze, and it now looks as if the gamble has paid off. But the cause of the fire is still not known.
Well, now space and the astronauts on board the Space Shuttle Challenger have completed the most important part of their mission. They've successfully launched a big communications and weather satellite for India. The timing of the manoeuvre had to be absolutely accurate. Newsround space editor Reg Turnhill has been watching the activity.
Launching the satellite started with opening the protective sunshade. Then, from the flight deck, astronaut Bluford punched the button to start it spinning. That's to keep it steady. India's two-ton all-purpose satellite lifted out perfectly, a launch for which India paid NASA £7 million. Already it's 36,000 kilometres above India, sending back its first signals. They'll operate it from their own mission control at Hassan, transmitting educational TV programs to remote villages all over the country. And half-hourly weather pictures should at last give advance warning to people living along India's east coast, where cyclones and floods cause so much damage and loss of life. Tomorrow, the astronauts will use the robot arm to wave around a four-ton dumbbell, practice for placing a small unmanned space station in orbit next year for recovery 6 months later.
A campaign to help
Indian weather and communications satellite has been successfully launched from the Space Shuttle Challenger. The first signals have already been received, but it won't come into full operation until the middle of October.
Had a brief scare today when a fire alarm sounded in their cabin during their 22nd orbit of the Earth. It turned out to be a false alarm, but caused what Commander Richard Truly described as a little excitement for a while. Three orbits earlier, black astronaut Guion Bluford launched a $50 million communications satellite for India.
You said at this point when it was spinning, you felt no vibrations or anything at all.
He had to get it spinning correctly before a giant spring pushed the one-ton satellite out into space. Booster rockets later lifted it into a higher orbit above the subcontinent, from where it will provide cyclone and flood warnings. And it all happened at sunrise, a mere 184 miles above India.
Athletics. Steve Ovett didn't get his world 1500 meters record back.
Is that the airliner may have strayed off course into Russian airspace. As anxious relatives of the passengers waited for news at Seoul Airport, the American government said that at least eight Russian fighter planes had reacted when the airliner was first detected. Later, a search had been ordered of the area. America has already protested to Russia, saying there was no excuse for this appalling act. A new government scheme to help school leavers got underway today, called the Youth Training Scheme. It's aimed at giving work experience and the chance of a job to thousands of teenagers who would otherwise leave school without any work at all. The new scheme replaces the old Youth Opportunities Programme and gives school leavers training in a wide variety of workplaces. During the course, which lasts a year, they're paid about £25 a week. Many school leavers, including these at a London market, have already joined the scheme. The government hopes that by Christmas, almost 500,000 teenagers will have joined it. With the Space Shuttle Challenger on the third day of its latest mission, American space scientists have announced they're sending a team of astronauts to Britain later this month. They hope to persuade British drug manufacturers to use some of the shuttle's special equipment for making medicines in space. Newsround space editor Reg Turnhill has the details.
Now that the space shuttle is operational, NASA wants to earn some money with it. So they're sending over Dr. Sally Ride, their first woman astronaut, with Fred Hawke, who flew with her on the last mission. And Sally Ride's astronaut husband, Steve Hawley, a research scientist, will also be here. We've been getting television pictures this week showing the ladder-like equipment at the back of Challenger's crew quarters, which makes medicines 700 times purer than those made on Earth.
NASA says there's no reason why Britain shouldn't be sending her own medical astronauts into space in the next 10 years. But first reaction among British scientists is that it'll all be rather costly.
Now on BBC One, at 20 to 6, here's Jan Leeming with the evening news.
Negative, with no vibrations at all. We did get a large thump right there at deploy itself.
A disabled yachtsman sailed into Penzance after voyaging 2,500 miles to the Azores.
Yes, we may have the sound. I mean, for the benefit of people who have not been following the story too closely and those who are interested in technical details, it's about the size of a DC-9 airliner, if anyone has travelled in one of those.
And the main
cargo bay, I'm told, is about 60 feet long and 15 feet wide. Here we are.
I think we can hear the sound anyway.
From the 65 knots. No pictures.
No pictures as yet. There's the picture of the idea
feet
of it.
Altitude, range 8.6.
Just hear what they're saying. I think they're just talking about timings at the moment.
This is the voice of Mission Control. We're going to stay with the sound in the hope that we do get some pictures, and certainly until the landing, because it is momentous occasion.
The infrared imaging system picking up the orbiter.
Whatever that is. What we do know, of course, is that they're past the most
dangerous point
of the entire
mission. Right.
9,600.
Which gives it that visibility. And I gather also they've lit the runway to be visible at 100 miles. So obviously they've looked at the public relations of the exercise very considerably.
Indeed, yes. So about 3 minutes ago, we're just about a minute off from landing now. 3 minutes ago, they would have flown over Edwards Air Force Base before making their final turn. So they'll have seen the runway illuminated below them, and the people on the ground would have heard the sonic boom.
Can we just eavesdrop and listen to what they say?
3 miles. Airspeed 300 knots.
Gear down.
Range 1 mile.
It's a beautiful sight, isn't it? Here it comes.
Oh, there it is, caught by the lights.
Never fails to attract us at that wonderful moment when it touches down.
And we mark touchdown at 8 minutes 40 seconds.
Well, there they are, safely home, Ian. We saw them take off last week. Of course, what's gone on in between that time, the takeoff and the landings are so dramatic that we tend now to lose sight of what happens in the meantime. And, of course, lots of other big stories have broken in the meantime. Mm. Have they done well? I mean, has it all been a great success?
Yes, they've had a very fruitful 6 days in space. NASA has been saying they can't imagine that any crew could have done better. They've had a busy 6 days in space. We know that they successfully ejected the Indian satellite into orbit the day after they were launched on Wednesday. Although, as we said, just this morning we have heard that there has been a problem with deploying one of the solar panels on that satellite which generates electricity. That's not the shuttle's fault, it's the satellite's fault, and they'll be having another go to try and sort that problem out later today. They've been doing experiments with the robot arm, which next year is planned to pluck a satellite out of orbit for repair. And they've also been trying out the tracking satellite, which was launched in April and which went initially into the wrong orbit, and it took them several months to get it into the right orbit. And that tracking satellite will be very useful for the next mission, which is going up on October the 28th. And this will have a European astronaut on board working aboard the European-built Space Lab space station, which will be carried in the shuttle's cargo bay.
I must ask you the question, how are the rats that went up? Are they okay? Have they survived the trip?
Yes, the rats adapted. The doctor, William Thornton, whose job it was to look after them, said for the first day they were asking for the price of the ticket back, because they obviously didn't enjoy it very much in weightlessness for the first day, but they've now adapted, and so presumably we'll be seeing more experiments using rats in the future. And of course there's also a problem, not just rats having to adapt, but the astronauts themselves. And the doctor said that he had a few patients suffering from space sickness on the first couple of days, and although no names were named, from the way he said it, I got the impression that he was one of the people who was himself was suffering from space sickness.
Ian, as we take one last look at it now, sitting on its finishing pod, as it were, in the gloom of Edwards Air Base, what is the next planned move? It's going to become more commonplace, this trip, and develop in that way?
Yes, they're all making it look very easy, aren't they? This was probably the riskiest landing since the first one, and yet it's gone absolutely like clockwork. The next mission, Shuttle 9, on October the 28th, we'll be seeing Columbia, the first space shuttle, coming back into flight, because that's been in the hangar undergoing a refit. And it's been fitted with this European Space Lab space station in the cargo bay. And that will be going up for a 9-day flight. And the pilot there will be the first shuttle commander, John Young, who will be returning to the skies in Columbia again. So that will be a nice sight to see that flying again.
Absolutely. He probably knows more about the flight.
Challenger has landed safely at Edwards Air Force Base in California at the end of its 6-day mission. The landing, seen with the help of infrared cameras, was another first for the shuttle program. It was the first time the shuttle had landed at night. The runway was lit up by powerful searchlights, and it was a perfect landing after one of the most successful of Challenger's missions. The highlight was the deployment of an Indian communication and weather satellite, although that's now causing concern because ground control can't extend its solar panels. The astronauts now face a detailed debriefing back at their base in Houston. In France, a pilot died when two aircraft collided during an air display at Niort, 250 miles southwest of Paris. The collision happened soon after the start of the display by the French Patrol Aerobatics team. One of the pilots was killed in the crash, the other parachuted.
In 5 minutes on BBC One, Animal Magic. Before that, here's John Craven's Newsround.
What Britain's children eat. A survey says it's not good enough. Hello again. As many as 2 million children could be putting their health at risk by eating the wrong foods. That's the claim of a report out today. The results of a nationwide survey of children's eating habits have been studied by a top food expert and published by Woman magazine. The report says most children don't have a properly balanced diet, and 5 in every 100 children eat very badly indeed. And that, say the experts, could mean ill health in adult life. Paul has the details.
The various types of food eaten by almost 4,500 people were closely monitored and listed during one day in the summer term. How much and how often they ate, from morning to evening, was also looked at. The results were then analysed by a food expert. At school, chips were the most popular choice in the cafeterias. 3 out of 4 in the survey chose them, but chips are high in fat. Salads came low on the list, but stressed the authors of the survey, they would be a healthier choice. Sweets, foods containing a lot of sugar, proved to be high in popularity, but too much sugar in your diet can be dangerous. The survey showed too that chocolate, toffees and fizzy drinks were all big favourites. It's a daily diet that comes in for harsh criticism from the food expert. More fresh fruit and vegetables should be eaten. They contain important vitamins for our health. But many people in the survey had no fruit or vegetables in their diet. In fact, only 1 in 17 people were given high marks for the food they eat. All in all, it seems Britain's young eaters are having too much of what's bad for them and not enough of what's good for them.
The Russians have reacted angrily this afternoon to American claims that they shot down the South Korean airliner with 269 passengers on board. They say the claims are a plot by the American spy service, the CIA, and that the Americans have no evidence to back them up. And there's been cautious response to President Reagan's call for countries to ban the Soviet airline Aeroflot. So far, only Canada has done so. West Germany and Switzerland have refused. Japan says it doesn't want to spoil relations with Russia, and Britain hasn't announced yet what its response will be. In a speech last night, President Reagan played a tape of the Russian pilots who, he said, shot the plane down while it was in Soviet airspace just north of Japan. Nation Security Council today. And President Reagan said the pilot described his search for the target before he shot it down, and he'll be playing the whole tape to the United Nations Security Council today. Well, meanwhile, airline pilots are considering refusing to fly through Russian airspace. Members of the International Federation of Airline Pilots Associations are meeting in Britain at the moment to decide whether to go ahead with the ban.
The American Space Shuttle Challenger is back after its six-day mission. NASA called it the cleanest mission yet, and it ended with the shuttle's first nighttime landing at Edwards Air Force Base in California. In the atmosphere over the Pacific, it glowed like a meteor.
This was potentially the most dangerous landing since the first shuttle came back in April 1981. It was the first time they'd tried to touch down in the dark. Nevertheless, the landing was perfect. The shuttle coasted down onto the runway at Edwards Air Force Base exactly on time. Challenger was back. The whole journey had been remarkably trouble-free. As they came to the cabin door, the astronauts were able to reflect that NASA is now capable of landing a space shuttle as effortlessly as an ordinary plane. During the course of their mission, the five crewmen launched a satellite for India and carried out numerous tests. They even took up rats to see how they responded in weightless conditions. Even so, one or two of the men looked a little wobbly as they wandered around their craft. No one seemed surprised, for in the past 6 days they've hurtled more than 2.5 million miles through space and are otherwise none the worse for it. Once inside, they were quick to praise the Challenger.
The real hero tonight is the Challenger. Already she's been towed up toward the hangar. Won't be too long before she's heading back to the launch pad and going to be going again.
There was also a warm reception for America's first black astronaut, Guyon Bluford.
I think we have a tremendous future with the space shuttle, and I anticipate that we'll be flying the vehicle many more times in the future, doing many more jobs, helping this country both domestically as well as militarily.
But first, the Challenger heads off for a service. After flights totaling over 6 million miles, it's time for a checkup and a well-earned rest.